5.4. Definitely going to be interesting to see if we see some of those international strategies coming into the OPL. Everyone's had that extra 10 days or so to just, you know, refine their game, look at other scenes, see what's good. Lulu, of course, probably going to be a contested pick. Be interesting to see if any of the Oceanic teams are bringing out the Juggernaut, which is finding so much success around the world. Yeah,
we'll have to see here as the bans continue. Hecarim, the first ban for Sudden Fear. Xerath, the pick there for Dire, was a targeted ban, actually, there towards Apep. So some respect there for the mid laner and Sudden Fear. Going to pick one more here, and it's actually Morgana as the second.
And the Dire Wars, of course, have been using Morgana in multiple lanes, despite the fact that Perfection has been one of the most mechanically impressive top laners. They have been building those comps around King. Actually, they are one of the teams that have tried Juggernaut already during the OPL. We've actually seen Morgana mid come through. Xerath's been one of Sharp's strongest champions, so to ban out on the blue side tells me Direwolves, they've got something different to show us.
Yeah, and definitely respecting the other mid laner. There is Rek'Sai, the other strong jungler here, along with Nidalee, is going to get banned, so going to have some different choices there for both these teams, actually. And Sudden Fear have got one more choice to make now.
See what the last ban is. Of course, so many strong champions, but what I have to say about 5.4, feels like there's less must-ban champions. Suddenly, Kassadin, he makes it through the picks and bans. He falls through the picks, away from the Rift for at least one patch pastry time, yeah, as 5.5 sees some tweaks. Also, the Vega support, sadly no longer with us. And the last ban is that Kalista.
Yeah, and that will leave Lissandra open, and Perfection takes it instantly.
I mean, it's interesting. Lissandra's been one of the few champions that has been unchanged among the top meta picks. Some teams pick it, some teams play it. Sometimes it kind of struggles to impress, but it's a very reliable champion. It's a flex pick in the top and mid, a very safe first lock-in.
Yeah, it definitely is a flex pick, but wouldn't be surprised at all for it to go into the hands of Perfection. His Lissandra play throughout the OPL has been just fantastic to watch. So a very strong first pick, like you mentioned, doesn't give much away here in Sudden Fear. They're going to make their first two picks. These are hard ones.
I mean, the interesting thing about it is that we previously talked about Kassadin as a flex pick, but Kassadin doesn't necessarily have the wave clear Lissandra has. So for it to be a flex pick and also give wave clear, you give nothing away from your team comp whatsoever with that pick.
Yeah, it looks like a pretty powerful mage going to be hovered by Sudden Fear. LeBlanc and Ahri, probably the two most notable mid laners still left open on 5.4, and I believe Sharp at least have been playing a lot of Ahri on 5.2 and transitioning to 5.4. Couple of choices here for Sudden Fear. They might lock in these first two picks, it seems like, here. Again, the jungler pool kind of got shredded with Nidalee and Rek'Sai being banned out, so it is going to be Lee Sin and LeBlanc.
And the starting of a very strong pick comp for Sudden Fear. And again, a return to the LeBlanc. We already mentioned that Sharp struggled in this matchup. He took Ahri into the matchup last time, struggled in lane, but made plays around the map. When you're combining it with a pink Bomi on Lee Sin, I think there's a lot of potential for picks coming out from Sudden Fear. And if he can translate what was a winning lane matchup last time into picks with his jungler, that could be massive for Sudden Fear if they want to take down Direwolves.
Yeah, and important to note for the Wolves as well, playing with a substitute jungler here as well. Yo-Yo has joined the roster for tonight's game here. Soulstrike's absent for this game for whatever reason, so you have to sub someone in. That might ruin some of the synergy there as well on the team, but King has already got Corki, and that's a pretty good pick for him.
I mean, one thing you have to know is the ban of Rek'Sai on blue side, if this was Soulstrike's on the team, that wouldn't have come through. Soulstrike such a wonderfully strong Rek'Sai player, been one of his most impressive champions in the OPL. But with the substitution, they ban it on the blue.
Yeah, and looks like Direwolves might even pick up a complete bottom. And we already mentioned that Corki's locked in, and there's going to be Thresh for Chuffer.
Doesn't really feel like a King champion, though, does it, the Corki? He's been so good on the hyper guys, loves to outplay people. Still, of course, you have the Valkyrie, so you can go for the outplay players nonetheless. But this strikes to me that Direwolves want to play a more rotational game. They want to look to take those early turrets, rotate around with the Trinity Force Corki's fight, rather than necessarily waiting for King to hit those big item timings on champions like Vayne, hyper carries like Kalista. And the answering picks come through, and plenty of power on Sudden Fear's side.
I was going to say, though, if we're going to classify King at all as an AD carry, I think aggression might be fairly good word to use. If you remember that game against Fauna on Graves, actually, just went ballistic, basically, on their champion. So King's certainly not afraid to get in there with a champion like Corki, but Sudden Fear might answer power with power, like you mentioned. They're considering Lulu, they lock it in, and they'll have Graves here as well, which is really interesting with a mid-game carry, but this change might be a little bit better for M from them.
Just considering their options, remember they don't have a lot of wave clear from LeBlanc, so they need the wave clear from other places. That's why we see the Lulu lock, and Lulu from support offers decent wave clear. Lulu top lane, which is the more expected thing, plenty of wave clear. And Lucian, no slouch himself.
Yeah, Lulu Lucian, the potential lane there as well. That's a tongue twister, and I like it. I mean, we're starting to see more Lucian, specifically against Corki and Kalista, who are very popular carry champions in the bottom side, and he's perfectly serviceable late game and decent mid game.
And despite the fact that he's been tweaked and his numbers aren't a strong early game, he still has a wonderful matchup in lane because Piercing Light has that instant cast time, very hard to juke unless you're perhaps Vayne tumbling out of that ability. And, you know, in those trades against Corki, we have to remember, Corki's strong laning phase is completely derived from Phosphorus Bomb auto trades. When you've got the Relentless Pursuit, the instant dash, you're able to get the Piercing Light trades in, use the Relentless Pursuit to get out of that queue and just win trades against Corki. And then, as you mentioned, both champions strong in the mid game and maybe a slight advantage to Lucian in the late game.
Yeah, I mean, he's very good, hyper mobile with a bunch of items in towards the late game. It's funny that Graves was kind of a thing we started seeing more, and Lucian almost feels like an upgrade for the late game slightly. But Direwolf's going to really go all in on the mid game here. We have Victor, the pick here for Sharp, and Jarvan finally picked up. They have a jungler.
Actually, I was looking at Sharp's match history in solo queue previous this game. A lot of Victor coming through, so not surprised to see it. So much regular wave clear. The moment you pick up the Aftershock, the Death Ray enchant, and he's taken it into multiple AD Assassin matchups in solo queue. He takes Exhaust in those situations. Of course, Assassin's one of the best ways to deal with Victor is that gap close, so Zed and Yasuo, popular picks against the Victor. We'll have to wait and see. It's going to be, of course, Victor versus LeBlanc, a big wave clear advantage, although this is an interesting last hover.
Yeah, curious to see what Sudden Fear do want to take away for their last pick. Kind of missing a support or a top laner, depending on where they want to put the Lulu. LeBlanc probably in the mid game, probably not support, but you never know here with Sudden Fear. They got some stuff. Brawler especially loves to play off meta support.
And let's talk about this while it's being hovered, because it's a Galio, of course. We can all dream about the Galio, but the champion has seen so much respect, specifically in the OPL. How many target Sion bans have they had ever since Swiper popularized this super tank in the top lane? Is actually locked in. So Sion, I believe, might even have near 100% win rate in the OPL. Sudden Fear lock it away.
Yeah, very strong. Completes a really well-rounded comp here for Sudden Fear as well. Good pick potential, lots of burst, good utility coming from the Lulu, and of course Solution for very smooth mid to late game carry power.
I mean, the only question mark is the wave clear with the AP Lulu, of course, with the decent scaling on the Glitter Lance, excellent wave clear coming through. When it's from support, it's decent, but they're going to have a little bit more short-range wave clear to clear these waves in the late game.
Yeah, it sounds like a lot of Lucian ultimates maybe going to be helping out, because the culling, of course, decent there, but kind of a long cooldown, even at rank 3.
Absolutely. So, yeah, the 60 seconds, the 70 seconds, the 80 seconds. Excellent wave clear when it's available, but not reliable like AP Lulu's Glitter Lance.
And it's funny that we already mentioned Victor and his wave clear. They've got Lissandra as well, so very strong AoE-centric double AP here for the Dials, very mid-game centric, but they can clear waves for days.
They can clear waves for days. This is the mention, you know, it's just one champion short of three strong wave clear champs. Corki decent, specifically can get a few rockets off into the back line. But, I mean, Lissandra and Victor, what can you say about wave clear? And I really like what Direwolves has put out, specifically Pastry Time, because in that mid game, you rotate around to the mid lane. If you're Corki with the Trinity Force, already so much turret damage, you have Victor who has strong wave clear, can plop down the gravity field. You take turrets, and Lissandra ever rotates the wave clear, it's unbelievable. You have dive pressure. It's a double AP comp, but there's so much space control. And the Corki, I love Corki with champions like Victor, because you take advantage of the space control and smash down those turrets.
Yeah, and we've already mentioned almost a million times at this point the rotational power of Corki with the Trinity Force, Victor adding so much to that, like you mentioned. So good stuff there for Dolves as far as team comp goes. But as I said, I like the bounce from Sudden Fear, so maybe the junglers is where we should start here. Very aggressive, very traditional jungle matchup here with Jarvan versus Lee Sin.
Yo-Yo making his debut on the competitive scene on the Jarvan. The pick power that comes with that champion, Thresh as well, CC in the lanes, makes me kind of lean towards Jarvan as having the advantage, just because whatever lane he visits has instant CC. Maybe not mid lane, of course, the gravity field, I believe, this does take time to arm, so that not necessarily as strong pick CC, but Lissandra, of course, has multiple CCs in the top lane, Thresh in the bottom lane. Lee Sin, though, no slouch, and Lee Sin and LeBlanc potentially can take over this game, especially if we see another MVP-worthy LeBlanc performance from Apex.
Yeah, and I guess the other nice thing for Sudden Fear is that this Sion almost functions like a Mundo in this comp as a super tank, because you look over the Dials lineup, lots of mid-game power, double AP, Corki does decent late-game damage, but probably gets outscaled a little bit, at least by Lucian. Who's going to bust through this Sion?
And that's a good consideration, Peshtime. No real tank busting coming through from the Direwolves team. So although it's not necessarily as much of a ticking time bomb as Mundo, Mundo definitely is late game insurance if there ever was one, with that ultimate just replenishing your health bar. But we've seen people try to break through, especially Swiper's Sion, and just have an exercise in frustration. So it'll be very, very difficult to break through the front line if the game goes long enough. But with so many mid-game picks, rotational advantages, even teamfight advantages in the mid-game, I feel like Dire Wolves, they just need to get that dragon advantage, specifically get towards the third and necessarily the fifth dragon, and work their way towards the objectives, because they should have those in the mid game, and just make sure the late game's never really a true consideration.
Yeah, just, you know, want to make sure that they can move through effectively, get everything the way they want. Again, there's going to be a lot of power coming through, you know, around the second, third dragon mark. Mm-hmm. We see this so much in games on the last few patches in this season, is this, that everyone likes to pick mid-game, control the dragon, because even with a two-threat comp, getting the fifth dragon just carries you far enough into the late game that it doesn't really matter.
Absolutely. I mean, just the burn on auto attacks, the 12% statistics. Silence tanky will have a Frozen Heart, probably a Warmogs at some point during this game. But with enough damage on all these members, high damage, double AP, Jarvan from the jungle does decent damage, and Shreds, of course, Sion's armor, and Corki, we talk about him as not a tank buster. He still does a lot of damage in the late game.
Yeah, it does plenty of, even AoE damage in some
mostly
ways as
AoE
well.
AoE damage,
yeah, which is really strong stuff, especially in short range. Going to move into the mid lane now a little bit as we look Victor versus LeBlanc. You mentioned that Victor might struggle against Assassins. Apep's probably confident here in this matchup.
Absolutely. I definitely give the advantage to LeBlanc just because have to really respect the double gap close, especially from level 6 when the Mimic comes through. The Mimic distortion can be so strong against a mobile champion like Victor. Victor has to be very careful with his positioning. He really wants to just rush down that 1,000 gold enchant, because then he can, of course, he takes out the backline instantly with one death ray and kind of move back to his turret. If he's ever overextended, the Lee Sin LeBlanc combination can definitely get on top of him and burst him. But if he can play back, get that first 1,000 gold and just farm from range, he'll be happy enough. It just gives Apaps the chance to roam with his jungler. And if Apaps and Pink Bomi can start taking over the other lanes, it'll definitely be the advantage that Sudden Fury are looking for in the mid game.
Yeah, and I love that you mentioned the overextension, because that was my next point here. You talk about Sharp, definitely been practicing the Victor in solo queue. Seen Choo-choo's play actually for the first day in this round here a couple days ago now, almost 2 weeks ago at this point. But Sharp going quite aggressive with the summoner spell choice. It's not the exhaust against the assassin, it's the aggressive ignite.
And sometimes ignite, you have to remember, is a bit flexible, because if someone tries to turret dive you and you have ignite, it might dissuade them from fully committing. Maybe it's just a call from the jungle and saying, look, I'm going to focus mid lane, take the ignite, and we can win early trades. There's always the potential there, but Sharp, you have to remember, he's used to the Xerath. He's used to the wave clear champions. Not always known as an aggressive player. It was very late to pick up Ahri, for example. And he just, you know, prefers the wave clear. That's why I was so surprised to see the Xerath ban, because Xerath's still very strong on this patch. I feel like aggression's not necessarily his first nature, at least in competitive play on the highest level of Oceanic League of Legends. Maybe he'll prove me wrong.
Maybe. I mean, Victor certainly suits him just generally as a champion, sure. But the Ignite is maybe a bit more of an aggressive choice. Moving through the rest of the lanes, Chuffer does have Ignite, so of course Chuffer. I'm actually surprised he
surprised?
Didn't take it. Annie was open he didn't take it, because he's very aggressive.
I mean, he had the Corki, so you could theoretically go on for the more aggressive bottom lane choice. But of course, the flexibility coming through from Thresh, I was about to say, it's Chuffer. You know the Ignite's coming.
Yeah, he just loves Ignite here. And we do actually have an exhaust on the other side, so pretty balanced across the board here. But we are onto the Rift now. Dire Wolves versus Sudden Fear here. The Wolves on the blue side, Sudden Fear over on the red. Both teams hungry for a win here, but Dire Wolves looking to solidify that spot towards the top, and Sudden Fear trying to pick themselves up and make a big run at the end towards playoffs.
Look, Sudden Fear got the LeBlanc, and they have the mid lane pressure advantage, so I feel like at least in picks they've kind of fulfilled their win condition of giving themselves a chance, giving themselves a clear win condition in terms of actually being able to overtake the mid game against a mid game focused comp. If Victor's playing reactionarily, can't follow LeBlanc when she roams, there is that potential for Sudden Fear to snowball their other lanes.
Yeah, we can see a fan out now coming through as well. Actually, a bit of aggression here from the Wolves pushing in towards the top side of the map towards Christmas Trees. Actually, Chuffer going to whack him there. No skill up yet though, but Sudden Fear defending with three of their own.
What I really like to see against Sion comps is start warding those camps. You have the five wards at level one. Get vision of the camps that Sion loves to take, loves to suicide to get that early level two. Whether it's the Raptors, whether it's the Wolves, those are the two camps we often see. So just ward them out and ensure that you're just either predictable with your teleport to lane, so you can either freeze or push accordingly, or contest Sion when he tries to go for that and get some kill goal.
And you can see right there, the Wolves right on your level there as far as that goes. Apaps very aggressive there with the distortion, but just poking his head in for a bit of extra vision, but they've warded up the Raptor camp.
Yeah, so they've warded up the Raptor camp. So look, if Sion does want to go for this camp, and realistically they won't necessarily be able to close the distance to get it down, at least they'll have predictability about the exchange. And speaking of predictability, the ward also comes down at the Grumps. So much vision advantage for Dire Wolves, and this is only 2 minutes into the game.
Yeah, Yo-Yo actually going to clear out his Grump now as well, so both junglers going to start on the same side. Sion is clearing out the Wolf camp though, so we'll have that available to him, but as like you said, plenty of information early on. There's Christmas Trees.
Christmas Trees, very close to death. This is always the way with Sion. That's why you don't take Sion players in your fantasy teams, Pastry Time. This is always the result.
It's just horrible here. Azir's going to finish up the camp, get a level 2, and pop in towards the top. So we are going to break out in the standard lanes, though, here. So King going to get another 2v2, and he seems to excel in these situations.
Absolutely. I think he's so confident to opt into 2v2s. It's quite an even lane. Even though we say Lucian has options against Corki, there's still a thresh. We have to talk about the support matchup. Brawler loves to play this support Lulu. In laning phase, if you're playing aggressively, the wave clear is so helpful. But before level 6, doesn't really contribute that much to a fight. I say that even though she has a shield, she has a Glittolance, she's just not really that useful in all-in trades. She much prefers to be poking from the backside.
Yeah, use that spell tips, get a bit of extra golden poke down here as we pop into the top side. Now Perfection versus Christmas Trees. A bit of a CS lead here for Perfection as he did start in the lane early. Didn't choose to freeze those, trying to push it in a bit.
And the thing about Christmas Trees on this Sion is that Sion can work towards early magic. It's probably the Spirit Visage. And it's doing triple duty against this lineup. Double AP and also Corki being the AD carry does mostly magic damage, at least in the early game. You can tell that by the Sorcerer's Shoes that Corki players love to pick up. Magic is going to be very strong, but look at that hook.
Great hook there as well. King will follow in for some damage. A good trade, though, for Lucian there with that passive. And even though a great hook landed by Chopper, you can see Lucian excels in these sort of small trades.
Absolutely. Winning a skirmish despite being the one hooked is a bit scary for Corki. Able to walk out of that phosphorus bomb. So King, using his mana pretty liberally, trying to get lane control as much as possible.
It's pretty interesting here as well, because like you said, two very mid-game-centric, fairly aggressive AD carries, but the difference is almost in the instant damage from the Lucian passes versus the slightly slower Phosphorus Bomb.
Absolutely, Phosphorus Bomb, one of the big rework changes when they gave it more range, was to make it slower, so it is dodgeable. And King is not getting a lot of favorable trades in the bottom, and you can tell that by his flashing health bar, as in the top, the wave clear battles are on.
Yeah, I mean, it's Sion Lissandra that's pretty much just going to be wave clear for days going back, as we do have a slight pause in the game, so welcome back here. Again, really good stuff coming through just in general. I love the matchup here. I think Emperor Moon taking it to King in the bottom lane is probably quite a big thing there.
Absolutely. I mean, the fact that he's able to trade so aggressively is a significant factor for Emperor Moon back in the lineup. And look at this, we're already back into the game.
Yeah, so popping right back in there, King versus Chopper. Still here in the lane sharp, though, has actually done quite well to CS here against the LeBlanc. He's actually been pushing in and is about even on CS, but Apaps just biding his time on LeBlanc.
At the lanes. Still a lot of pressure coming on to King in the bottom lane. And look who's snuck in.
Yeah, Pink Bomi's actually down here on the Lee Sin. Q is going to land that Chopper in trouble. Their flay back and the flash might keep him safe, but damage still moving in. The heal popped as well. First blood is going to go to Lee Sin. Great dive there from Sudden Fear.
If Moon's one auto attack away from death, has to use the heal right at the end. Does live for another day, and King, he wants to keep putting on pressure, and this is why.
Yeah, Yo-Yo's here as well. Gets exhausted immediately, though. Infamoon dashes out. They're still moving in. Not quite enough damage. Brawler kills King there, but the trade kill will go down.
I thought Infamoon was going to survive. I thought maybe the auto attack wouldn't register, but it did. Excellent gank timing by Pink Bomi. King bought enough time for his jungle, but it didn't help out, and a significant advantage early for Sudden Fear.
Yeah, we talked about having a pretty volatile bottom lane down here with so many powerful early game carries. Both junglers paying attention. You can see what happens. 3 kills already.
And that's the case. When you're the first jungler to react, you can potentially get that first kill. If it was low members, if Chuffle was able to use the ignite, it might have been differently, but the pathing from Bomi was just superior to Yo-Yo this time.
Yeah, very nice stuff. They're sneaking in and picking up the early advantage for his team as he returned back now to Sharp versus Paps. Almost level 6 up here. Pink Bomi's at it again, wrapping around here, trying to get the other kill. Sharp gonna get chilling smited now as well. The gravity field comes out. Pink Bomi gonna, oh my god, I didn't know that worked that way.
That's how it works, Pastry Time. Unfortunately, it looked like it was going to be the smooth moves, the John Woo kick. It was, in fact, but in place.
Yeah, just kind of frozen in time there. So Sharp, very nice disengage. Going to use the gravity field to keep Pink Bomi out of that particular gank, and he'll chug his pots and be okay.
But this is the awkward nature of Victor before he gets the aftershock, before he gets the instant wave phase, that he can be overextended against LeBlanc. That was the window to gank, so I really credit Bomi for understanding that. The trades will be so different later in the map, as Paps is very low in the mid, has to back away.
Yeah, looks like LeBlanc is just going to move back there because he's recalling there over on the minimap. Sharp continuing to pressure and has done a very nice job, actually, just aggressively pushing in this wave, despite not having the augment. Should be picking it up relatively soon. It's about 1,000 gold, I believe, so pretty close to that one. And actually has a pretty decent CS advantage now that Paps is forced out of lane.
And the common build path for a Victor is to pick up that first augment. And then this is where builds start to differ. A lot of people favor the Merlin Omicron to move towards 20% CDR and a nice stack of AP. Some people move into the second augment just for the move speed. I believe both can be useful. I mean, it's situational with a lot of gank pressure. If you were against a Jarvan, absolutely go for the Q upgrade, the hyper speed, I believe it's called. But the Merlin Omicron fitted in at some point because 40% CDR, it's basically standard on all majors at the moment.
Yeah, really good stuff there coming through. But the first augment does come through there for the Hex Corso Sharp. Now going to have the instant wave clear for the backline that you talk about, King. Returning to the bottom side, just some components of a Phage and good flat AD here from Emperor Moon already with a pickaxe.
Romy's already showing up again using his 201 start. He's definitely snowballed in terms of items. You can compare him to Yo-Yo and see that quite plainly. Doesn't have necessarily mobility boots, but just the boots pick up from a jungler is a luxury purchase.
Yeah, pretty close into the warrior in chat there as well, as Yo-Yo gonna sniff it for a gank in the mid lane, but does not find it. LeBlanc pretty tricky to lock down here with the flash and all of the distortions up, but Yo-Yo at least entertains the idea of a gank.
Yeah, he just expects Paps to go aggressive, which he does just after he leaves, so it's all about the timing. As the wave control on bottom, it's quite considerable. And is this the first time we've seen King fall behind in CS early in a laning phase?
I think it is, actually. He's just been so good at picking up CS. He seems to just live on farm. But right now, struggling against Emperor Moon, who's classically played quite a lot of Lucian, probably happy that it seems to come back.
But still plenty of time to pick up those big CS values. Sometimes we just look away and he shows up with 100 out of nowhere. Don't even know where he finds that many minions based through time. Definitely been King's strong suit is the farming. But in the early lane, you can see that's all due to Bomi and the jungle pressure from the lead.
Yeah, they are going to push it in now, but Bomi certainly has done a great job early, actually donating the blue over there as well. King actually forced a Valkyrie out there, almost gets poked back, and again, going to CS as best he can. Chopper will help out with the Relic Shield, but first Dragon's going to be started by Sudden Fear.
They're trying to translate their lane pressure in both mid and bottom into a Dragon. It looks like they'll be able to. Victor's gone for a walk up top lane. I guess he must have been spotted by a ward, or maybe they just noticed that he was fading towards the top side because they get an uncontested dragon. And Sudden Fear, they need this victory. They need to start moving towards the playoffs. And they're setting themselves up with a wonderful first 9 minutes.
Yeah, very good start here. Only 400 gold in the lead, but the first dragon going to give them more advantages there as well. And Lucian barely misses a beat in the bottom side, even in CS now, despite leaving the help for Dragon.
Yeah, King's just not looking to push this lane because he's been punished multiple times already, and it's really prompted the pressure from the jungle. So just trying to get CS where he can. You know, it's not necessarily a favorable matchup, but not necessarily an advantageous one either. And Bomi, he's looking for any chance of bot lane being overextended because he's always making his way towards the bot.
Yeah, kind of look towards mid as well, but I think remembers Sharp's gravity field. The flash is up for Victor as well. So kind of a hard one. Moon, though, gets hooked there by Chopper. King coming in for the damage, but Emperor Moon is doing so much work. The Wild Growth popped as well, but he'll have to dash away.
Yeah, Wild Growth popped early, maybe just respecting the ignite that's on Chopper. They don't want to go for any damage calculations with that ability later. Lee Sin has returned to his own jungle, and despite all this, he's basically using the Wild Growth as a mini sustain tool and keeps pushing in.
Yeah, the way the ulti works, it kind of gives you the health and then you return back with any health that you would have had. It's kind of a weird way that it works, but effectively healed there as the Cullen goes down, almost takes out King, and he's forced to back out from under the turret. Emperor Moon really wants to die, but Brawler snipes him with a Glitter Lance.
Wow, that's not like King not respecting the Glitter Lance damage. You don't see a lot of support Lulu. You forget the fact that a Glitter Lance has long range. It has decent base damage especially, and Chuffer trying to do return damage. He has the ignite. He wants do a surprise damage trade. Don't know if Enfamoon is going to overextend, and no, he backs away.
No, just gets a bit of extra CS and gets out from the box. Chopper used the ulti to try and get the solo kill, but Enfamoon on the Lucian. Sudden Fear, we talked about needing to get a good start, and this is a great start for their bottom lane.
Just uncharacteristic play coming through from King. He's been one of the shining lights of the OPL, a new person in the Oceanic scene, stepping on doing so many wonderful things, so many highlight reel things. As we see the trade in mid, I don't think that Lee Sin's going to get this kill.
Bomi running in as well, but Sharp already flashed away. Used his ignite as well in the all-in, but Paps is forced to back off.
Yeah, that was a really high impact trade. Paps living on about 100 health. We can see the slivers finds his way back to the base turret as Perfection was considering trying his luck in other lanes.
And Perfection's actually had a pretty slow game so far in the first 11 minutes. I mean, ahead on CS slightly of Christmas Tree, doing just fine, actually doing about 40% of the turret's health in damage as well. But, you know, hasn't used his teleport aggressively yet. Direwolves haven't looked to contest for the first dragon that was taken. And Perfection, as always, just quietly overachieving.
But worth mentioning that, you know, he's laning against a Scion, so kill pressure against a Scion, even early, is minimal at best. He enters lane always with an experience advantage because he takes that extra count. So he's either going to be competitive or ahead in experience. You know, he's already built up the Spectre's Cowl. Not going to kill the Scion.
No, Perfection might make a go of it, though. Actually, Christmas Tree is going to get aggressive. Good damage here from the Scion. The E will miss, so W will pop and do good damage. But Perfection actually going to use the ulti. Doesn't have Ignite. Now Scion going to turn it up. Perfection might have gone a little too far. That damage coming in. The Flash comes in as well. The Q is going to get charged up. Perfection gets the last auto. And Christmas Trees gets a solo kill in top lane.
Direwolves are playing on autopilot. And I love that you mentioned that it's on Perfection, Pagetime. A solo kill. Don't know if there's been one of those this season. Perhaps coming through from Swiper early in the season as the distortion gets Paps away from Yo-Yo. Uncharacteristically poor play from the Dials, and Sudden Fear, they're out to play today.
Yeah, 5-1 here, up 1,000 gold or so. Paps, very nice ward, gets him away from the Jarvan gank as well. Really sick reactions there on that W, and even the mid lane for Sharpie was playing aggressively before, but he's got Negatron Cloak here.
Gone Negatron Cloak. That's a very interesting first item. I think just respecting the gap close damage coming down from LeBlanc. Okay, it delays his item build, not going for either Merlinomicon, a burst of AP, or another one of the augments. But look, if it helps him navigate landing phase, he'll definitely scale very well into the late game, and perhaps just doesn't have that solo kill potential. Yeah. Everyone else is doing it.
Yeah, probably Abyssal coming through there as the first item, which is just fine, but more of a farming item, I guess. So Victor Chuffer, though, trying to line up something here. Yo-Yo's actually in the bottom as well. Infamoon might have taken the bait. Chuffer a little too low, but does time it nicely. Flashes out of the Cataclysm and an instant teleport coming in for Christmas Tree. Scion gonna run in. Does not have his ultimate, but no CC that he can really throw out. Actually does nail the E there. Lee Sin trying to go in. Infamoon going so deep there. Gets Wildgrowth and actually gets the kill. A beautiful kick by Pink Bomey. Knocks up two, and Brawler gets the next kill. Chuffer will go down as well. Sudden Fear of eating there, we Bix Bubba Smithy.
A Sudden Fear with an absolutely impressive turret dive. Shades of Loveling from Worlds, you'd have to say. They just do it with aplomb, and they just keep pushing. Sudden Fear, something's in the water, and it's definitely only on their side.
Perfection, though, trying to line up a kill. He might get one. Pig Bomey gets locked up there by the ulti. Moves in for the E as well. Perfection can't quite get the next one, though. Polymorph, beautifully used by Brawler. Does get the double, though. Will go down, it looks like. He can't escape, but a very nice play for two kills.
Yeah, just answering some experience and kills, because of course, Sudden Fear had the extra stacks given how well they'd done early. We see in the mid lane, these are the only people not reacting. Usually LeBlanc, one of the fastest and most mobile champions, but struggling to deal with Sharp and his early Negatron cloak.
Yeah, just so much wave cliff in the Victor as well. I mean, he's going to have this cloak and be practically immovable. LeBlanc can kind of try and keep up in CS, but even Paps falling behind about 20-25 now as well. It's all that death ray.
But I think we just need to come back to how well coordinated that turret dive was. And the thing to take away is remember that it's actually Dials that have the mid-game team comp here. They're the one that we expected to be taking the first dragon, to be making the early move, to be taking the outer turrets. A turret to Sudden Fear, the first dragon, and just complete outplay underneath Dials' bottom lane turret. Sudden Fear, amazing rotational play.
Yeah, really strong stuff. And Infamoon's actually got an Infinity Edge now. He's been the big beneficiary of the early action here. 1, 2, and 6 already on the Lucian. Probably would have liked to move some of those assists into the kill column, but he'll take it at this point. King hasn't even got enough for the Zeal at this point. About half of the gold available in his bank right now for it. So not even Trinity 4C. King at this point would normally have already finished that
item. About 1,300 gold is the difference. And the extra crit... Brawler's Glove giving the crit actually negates the nerfs to the Infinity Edge. We'll be sitting around 30% crit. You do not want to be trading, especially if you're King with Infamoon at the moment. They have to respect this second dragon. Dialwolf's smart enough, experienced enough as a team to know this is not the one to contest.
No, and the second dragon will go to Sudden Fear very easily as well. Christmas Tree is actually already using his recall there, just getting hold of the dragon. Did do some damage here and cancel it, but they should be able to pick it up here. Paps returns early to his land, and Sudden Fear comes in complete control. Is he going to dive in onto Sharp there, Paps? So forced to get away. Oh, Brawler's moving in. Christmas Tree's coming in as well. The Wildgrowth nails in, but Yo-Yo is in the back as well. Brawler now unstoppable on the Lulu. Yo-Yo gets tagged by a Q and killed by Bomi, and Sudden Fear rotate in for another tower.
The rotations continue, but Paystrom, you have to ban Scion in the OPL. You'd have to think the choo-choo train went straight into mid and found Sharp. Two more kills for Sudden Fear. Second outer turret. Perfection did pick up the answering top turret during the dragon trade, but the extra mid turret, it's the icing on the cake.
And 4,000 gold up now for Sudden Fear. Infamoon relentlessly pushing here on the Lucian in the bottom lane now as well. Not afraid at all of King in a 1v1.
Relentlessly pushing. I see what you did there. Of course, he has the relentless pursuit to get away. If anyone comes to gank him, he'll be just fine.
Always moving forward relentlessly here as Infamoon actually does pop the calling. Very nice juke there as Chuffer moving in for the box, but Infamoon just stands there and takes it. Gets the kill there with a crit. Perfection will join in and clean out the kill. But that's a trade that Dialwolves, like, I guess they're happy with it.
I mean, it gets more gold onto the top laner, and it's of course a support for AD carry trade. It also relieves pressure from King, gives him more time to farm, probably will be able to pick up the Trinity Force. So definitely an overextension, but a sign of the times. Sudden Fear, they're playing confidently, and that's the best way to rattle these top teams, is not to be scared, to not respect the fact that maybe King might be a better mechanical player than you, but if you can outplay and out-rotate an enemy team, those individual differences, they just don't matter.
And Infamoon's looked very on par here in this start in the bottom side of the map already. Hilariously, I just noticed Brawler has 5 kills. I knew that Lulu picked up a couple, but there's a lot of extra gold there for a support.
Be interesting to see whether that goes into the Mikhail's, maybe even some AP. If he's feeling really feisty, Medjai's Soul Stealer, of course, Lulu's positioning in a team fight quite similar to Jarno in often cases, who doesn't necessarily going to die a lot. But that's not ideal, and that may come back to haunt them, you'd have to say. It's a lot of extra gold. In fact, if you compare the supports, he's ahead 2,400, 2,500 gold. But Direwolves rotating well, taking out a turret. At least in terms of turrets, this game's quite even.
Yeah, now even after a nice rotation from the Wolves, we'll move into the mid lane there as well. Actually, Brawler's turned his extra gold into a Frost Queen's Claim, so very snowbally there on the item, really trying to get ahead early. Embermoon seems to be moving into a Ghost Blade now as well, with an Avarice Blade in the inventory, although Static Shift perfectly fine as well.
Yeah, I'm going to guess that it might be the early Yoma's Ghost Blade, because it's an excellent snowball item on Lucian. You can activate the active and then use the Culling for a lot of extra statistics, gives you movement speed, the attack speed works with how the Culling interacts, and just the extra 20% early armor penetration. No one's going to be building armor anytime soon on the Direwolves lineup. They have to respect the magic damage coming out of Paps, so that's why you see the magic resist purchases coming out early. Enfermoon might be the beneficiary.
Yeah, it seems to be. Here is Corki actually on the other side. Finally got that Trinity Force pretty late to get that online there for King, but he at least has it and can use that as his jumping off point. Enfermoon going to take out the Rift Scuttler there. As Sudden Fear, still a lot of pink wards entrenched around the dragon area. It's not available yet, but they have so much control on the bottom half of this map.
They don't necessarily have the aggressive wards to complement how aggressively they've been paying. Remember, Enfermoon died basically under the inner bottom lane turret. If they can get some aggressive runes specifically around the enemy red buff, just to give them information about when that spawns, make the movements of Direwolves a bit more predictable. Credit to Direwolves. They've actually been pretty good at establishing a defensive perimeter and stopping the bleeding of global objectives.
Yeah, Bomi tries to find Yo-Yo, but a little wide there on that Q as Brawler going to rotate back down. Dragon must be up fairly soon as they're actually chasing him for some kills. Brawler pops up Frost Queen's Claim there for a bit of slow, but the Wolves back away.
It's no big deal, though. So Sudden Fear, they keep pushing the mid lane. What is their next objective? Maybe it's the last outer turret. We see multiple members at least were posturing towards the top. They don't want to be pushing in mid because Victor, he's got wave clear for days.
I mean, I think the awkward thing is that we already mentioned it, but both mages here for Direwolves have a lot of wave clear. I think they want Christmas Trees with his Warmogs to fight with his team, but Perfection with the Abyssal and 40% CDR, he's never going to stop pushing.
He's actually still pushing alone, so they've actually rotated Christmas Trees despite the fact that he has Teleport to the bottom lane. It gives Perfection free reign of the top. He's been the only one who hasn't been impacted by the early rotations. Bomi, he's looking to find Perfection. Actually, they spot him.
Nice scrying over there. Perfection going to get kicked back there. Might use the ulti on himself to try to get away with the path. Does use it there. Does get cold. The ulti comes out, but Enfermoon takes the kill.
Gets cold. Max range calling from Enfermoon gets another kill. We have to remember, Enfermoon actually hasn't been playing for Sudden Fear in their last couple of games. Energizer subbing in. Enfermoon returning with a massive early performance. And King, he's finding out that Sion doesn't do a lot of damage, but doing respectable damage this early into the game.
Yeah, not too bad. And of course, doesn't take any damage here as Chuff. Nails him with the hookup screen, but he'll just be fine here.
He always has the choo-choo train to run away at some point.
That ability is so funny here. Sharp is going to clear out the mid-wave minions here again. Victor, plenty of strong wave clear. Abyssal Scepter going to help out there as well. Lots of double AP damage coming in, actually. Christmas Trees still getting tied up in the bottom side. Chopper, another hook there, but Christmas Trees just not even going to use his ult. He has his flash. Box used there as well. I mean, Dials might not be able to get this. Christmas Trees might now have to flash. Does ulti there as well. Quite a lot of cooldowns used there, but Sion's fine.
Yeah, flash ultimate, actually. In the defensive manner, it's not Malphite, just flash ultimating away and gets away safely.
Yeah, and Enfermoon actually went for the static shift there. So, you know, a bit more aggression on the build, a bit more wave clear, I guess, maybe to stop some of the pushing coming through from the Direwolf mages. But Enfermoon at this point, 3, 3, and 6, any build probably would have been fine.
I mean, both of them to some degree are snowballing mid-game items, but you have to consider Yomu's, it's 6 seconds of power. Static Shift, a lot more regular power, a lot more wave clear coming through, and it's wave clear for a team that has a LeBlanc Sion as their solo lanes. They don't actually have the wave clear that Direwolves have, so going to Static Shift, probably the smart choice.
The Wolves are looking to contest for this next dragon. It seems like it's the third one. They really want to try and stop and start the snowball over there. Only hook will land onto Apaps there, but he's actually going to pop away there on LeBlanc. Distorts again there with the Mimic Yo-Yo. Going to get bound up there by the chance. Gravity Field on top of Christmas Trees, but Sion still tanking all the damage. Maybe he has to back off a bit there as he's not that tanky. A good hook there again lands in, but the kick will disengage Perfection. Finds Pink Bomi there, shot there, gets the next kill. deal with all the AWM for Moon. Kiting away, but he gets dove on now by King and the rest of Direwolves. Sharp gets another kill and a 4-for-1 team fight win.
The experience of Direwolves shone through in that fight. Sudden Fear made the critical error. Who's all the gold on? It's on M for Moon, and he wasn't grouped with his team while his frontline got chunked down. So when the fight actually started, both teleports came through. Perfection was able to do so much AoE damage in the front, and not even mentioning Victor, double Abyssal Scepter meant that the magic resist values were just so low for Sudden Fear. The frontline's destroyed, and it doesn't matter how fed your AD carry is if your frontline explodes.
Yeah, in short range, those two mages did ridiculous amounts of damage there. Victor actually getting a triple kill in that situation as well, and that 4,000 gold lead had shrunk to about 1,000. Might even go even now as King and Chuffer are working on the bottom turret.
500 range is for Moon, even more important when you have short-range AD carriers, a strong frontline. It didn't come through in that fight. And Direwolves, 300 gold, as you mentioned, is the gold lead. It's so much smaller than before. And even though it might not necessarily be the King show this time around, Direwolves, they've come to play.
And King is at least even on CS now again. Of course he is. Somehow caught up in the sidelines while we weren't watching. A Sharp returns now with a needlessly large rod. Probably looking to move into that Zonies as the next item. Level 13 on the Victor already. And we talked about the mid-game power for Direwolves. They picked really the last point they could to fight.
Absolutely. That was by far the tail end of the mid-game. But at least they found themselves and arrested a lot of the pressure coming through. Sudden Fear, they never got those wards we spoke about down aggressively. So now, I guess the true test is to work out, are they ready to try and forge another advantage? Can they recreate their excellent on-point dives, or will they become predictable and the top team here, Direwolves, be able to answer the call? We see they are getting some aggressive wards down. A Sudden Fear, they're trying to get vision around the Baron.
And that's really been the big thing for Sudden Fear, is too much neutral vision here when they had an advantage. You mentioned already that they didn't have the wards to be playing that aggressively, and still on the map here, all the vision for both teams really very centered around the river area of the map.
And snowballs don't necessarily have to be referring to big item purchases. They can be talking about snowball vision, you know, getting aggressive vision down before the enemy team can react, and maybe even have sweepers to be able to sweep out that vision. We talked about contesting the enemy red buff. King's just about to pick it up, as you can see on the minimap, and from him picking up his own red buff. They haven't been able to translate their early pressure into early control, and all of the jungle still available to Direwolves, despite the fact they were dying under their inner turret not a few minutes ago.
Yeah, and Direwolves now very firmly together as a group. King actually has an elixir ticking there as well, had it for the last dragon fight, so Direwolves went pretty all in on winning that fight, but King knew what he had to do and now looking very strong on the Corki again.
Of course, with the duration increasing after a team fight, potentially 2.5 minutes if you're involved in all 5 kills, it's a very strong early pickup, and it was a boost of power right when Direwolves needed it. If they've got a mid-game comp and they lose another mid-game fight, it's going to be a problem, as perhaps it's a nice burst trade onto King.
Yeah, good bit of poke there. Chuffer using Face of the Mountain actually there for a bit of an extra shield. Not opting for a Mikhail's just yet here, but might even move into protect his AD carry a little more, although maybe an Aegis is where he wants to be. Mikhail's, though, completed now by Broly, who's got a lot of kills, and Lockett actually done for Boney.
Now, what I want to see Sudden Fear do is put down some pink wards, as Paps going to get a pick on Yo-Yo.
Yo-Yo does get chained up there. Can't follow in, though. EQ just getting him across the wall.
Yeah, the pink wards are down on the map significantly from Direwolves. I believe one being cleared out, at least two or actually three on the map as we're seeing an engage.
Yeah, Chuffer actually using the box perfection, flanking to the side. King actually poking in there as well, but Chuffer caught in no man's land now as a pink Bomi going to run in. Should be able to clean up that kill. Misses the Q, but M for Moon takes it instead.
Absolutely. They could pass it to whoever, so of course they left it for their AD carry. Now 4, 4, and 6. The 4 deaths is a bit awkward, but in fact, 80 carries, 7 out of the 22 deaths have been from the 80 carry position.
And you know what? There was so much action in the bottom lane early on. I'm not particularly surprised, but it's been a very bloody bottom half of the map here. Sharp going to get aggressed on, but the ulti almost going to blow up. And for Moon, Wild Growth forced out there as well, but Paps actually snipes off Victor. Yo-Yo going to go down there for the double. And for Moon, Stewart going off, and Sudden Fear get too much needed kills. Christmas Trees running in now with the ulti. Perfection actually going to get tagged there. Follows the Q in as well. Gets the knockup. Paps finds the chain. Beautiful dive there, and King has to run away.
Sudden Fear's team fighting is so on point. I love the early Wild Growth because it empowered Enfamoom to re-engage and go aggressive in that fight. 4 members fall down as, of course, Chuffer died earlier. And Sudden Fear, what are they going to do to what are they going to take this? No dragon available. They don't necessarily have the pink wards. They have 2 pink wards in their inventory that they aren't placing. They need to start getting that aggressive wards. Otherwise, if this game ever equalizes, you feel there's so many resources for Direwolves to just delay the game and get to late game. Maybe their comp's mid-game centric, but it's still very potent in the late game.
Yeah, and same spot that Sudden Fear found themselves in not 10 minutes ago here. 4,000 gold ahead again after a big teamfight win. It's just a matter of converting it a little better. Dragon up in 120. Chuffer actually crewing up some wards, but Sudden Fear fear of some big shops to make.
And Direwolves, maybe they'll be afforded the same thing as, for example, Chiefs, who of course fell behind against Rich Gang, even fell behind against Sudden Fear in one of the earlier games in the season. But just their experience and knowing how to execute on win conditions and end games gave them the advantage of some of these new teams. Sudden Fear, they are a new team to the OPL this season. They've shown some waves. Can they convert a wonderful first 25 minutes where they're still ahead into a game victory?
Well, Ping Boom is going to go back and spend some of his gold before the next Dragon fight. Rabadon's done there for Pap, so plenty of early damage done. Frozen Heart complete for Christmas Trees after his Warmogs, and a BF sword almost completing the Bloodthirster for Boom. Infamy.
And the sustain will be so important with so much magic damage, AoE magic damage coming out from Victor and Lissandra and Corki, to be honest, even from the AD carry position. So just getting a bit of lifesteal because you're going to take incidental damage, just staying as healthy as possible, going to have the shield coming through. So much effective health between the Lulu shields, the Lulu wild growth, and then, of course, talking about the Bloodthirster shield. Maybe just a QSS to be bought after this item, and then he can work towards the Last Whisper, because again, the only big armor pickup is the Randuin's on Jarvan.
Yeah, I mean, Infamund is the centerpiece here of this comp at this point. Apeps definitely did some good weaving in and out of the last team fight and has good damage up front now as well. Even a Blasting One actually sneaking in there for pretty quick Void stuff if the game continues like this. Dragon back alive here, Sudden Fear to be there third, and Dialves again in the same position, have to deny another Dragon.
They have a lot of damage to neutrals, just mostly from Infamund, to be honest. They can try to rush this down. Perfection's not in position, but does have his teleport. Crucially, not his flash. Of course, not the longest range does Perfection have on the Lissandra, so might need the flash for repositioning in a fight. If they can force a fight before flashes are available, I think it'll be in the advantage of Sudden Fear.
Yeah, blue buff going to go to Apep, so Sudden Fear using that red side nicely. Here is the teleport. Will come in for Christmas Trees. He's going to join in early. Infamund just dodging that hook, and Sudden Fear aggress onto the dragon.
Infamund really tempting fate being at the front of these fights. It's not a Juggernaut comp. He needs to be careful with his positioning.
Yeah, good steal away there. Pink Bomi will smite it off there, and now Christmas Trees going to engage onto Yo-Yo. Damage review. Perfection trying to find the carry, but good culling back there as they disengage. Gravity Field out, zoning Scion back in there. Christmas Trees getting poked out a bit. Pink Bomi, the one who's ulted, does get blown up there, but the Wildgrowth used on the side. Perfection, a great zone. He's a double kill for King, who Vakar is straight in there, flashing over the top onto Infamund. He gets the triple. Corki now going in, almost a quadra there as Scion goes down, and Direwolves win another dragon fight with four kills.
Just can't keep a good man down. Big triple kill coming through for Corki. The aggression there was the big issue, though. Infamund got so chunked out before the fight started. They were split on wild growth targets. Everyone chunked down, so ended up being used on the Scion, who died in the front line anyway. Multiple individuals diving into the Direwolves comp, dying one for one. Target selection excellent for Direwolves. Game plan just a bit shaky from Sudden Fear.
Yeah, and unfortunately, at least for the Wolves, only three kills, not four, but did get a tower and not the dragon. So take some advantages here. 4-4-4 actually now in turrets, and catching up in kills again. 4,000 gold ahead for Sudden Fear. Big T-fight happens. Direwolves back to about 1,000 between.
Still a triple kill on King. That's the big issue. We're going to see the replay come through. Watch how Infamund is chunked out. It was a very good backwards move away from Perfection, but he's already at half health, and it's one man diving. It's just Christmas Trees. So eventually, as we see during a long fight, multiple members, both frontliners chunked out. Now Christmas Trees dead. You cannot fight as Lucian with all of your frontline alive, so there's just nothing they can do. King with the aggression for the triple kill. Need to really watch those threats, because Direwolves kited back so well, and Sudden Fear, again, the tanks just exploded in the front.
Yep, they'll take the Scuttercrab there as well. Will Sudden Fear and potentially look at the Baron buff, which might be the next big point of contention 30 minutes in. Definitely something that both teams are looking at here is Sudden Fear. The movement speed advantage as well, trying to move around the map, but Direwolves continue to get stronger, and again, can't help but look at Perfection. 3-4-7. Not the best score here for him. Certainly has had better games. But 50 CSL, 40 CS ahead, so of his top laner. His ultimate positioning is always on point.
And Infamund's just struggling with the 500 range to find areas to auto-attack, because first he has to respect all of Perfection's CC and damage. Then the gravity field comes out. You have to respect the cataclysm potentially coming through from Yo-Yo, and then the zoning hooks coming through from Chuffa. It's very difficult to function as an AD carry if your tanks are all diving in and the only appeal you have is from Brawler. That's why you have to choose the right spots to fight. When they've been fighting around the jungle, they've actually been able to use their repositioning abilities to get those frontline kills. But in the open area, the kiting back from Direwolves is just superior to what Sudden Fear were trying to do.
Yeah, Direwolves have powered up significantly in that last exchange as well. Zondi's complete there for Perfection, although I believe he had it in the last fight as well. Rabadon's now done for shot, plus the perfect Hexcar, I believe. So looking very strong, but Sudden Fear have cleaned up vision around the Baron. They're looking to try and take it away.
Now, Sudden Fear, they're baiting the Baron, but as Corki's not around, they can't really look to contest here, Direwolves. Finally, they do see Sudden Fear move away from the Baron themselves, so the warding battle continues, but they've given King a free shop, and he's gone back and bought the Last Whisper.
Yeah, good culling there coming through. Sharp actually getting chunked to about 60% health there. Sudden Fear going to move in aggressively, but again, just not the forward wards that they'd like. They've got plenty of turrets taken down, but they keep fighting in neutral areas on the map, which is, like you said, not where they want to be fighting.
And that's just the big takeaway. It's just the aggressive wards is the one thing they haven't followed up on, because, of course, their early rotations and turret diving was really on point. It was impressive from any standard, let alone OPL, but world standards. But it's in this situation where they haven't got the wards, there's relative darkness in all sides of the Direwolves jungle, and they just have to back away. They're not able to really exert any pressure or extend their lead.
Kind of looking through as well. Who's Pink? Bomi actually been caught out on the blue. It gets blown up there by King and Sharp as Victor takes the kill.
And again, no, not even an aggressive ward when they're looking to take away a cat means that Lucian just dies. You know, finds three members and dies, and now Direwolves are the ones to start to get the control around Baron.
They're going to rotate in towards the top side. Actually, Valkyrie already used there by King, who really wants to start the push on, will clean out the wave very quickly, and that big wave will push back towards the top side. But Sudden Fear running down the mid side now as well. Perfection actually already in the mid, pushing them back, and they're going to have a bit of a base race here. Perfection going to clean out, but Direwolves are still strong in the top side.
Now, Direwolves are continuing to push because they notice they have a wave clear and Sudden Fear don't, but they do have a Sion. They do have options to tank, and there's only one man defending for Direwolves.
Direwolves still pushing in though, and Sudden Fear, I think, realize they have to go back. Perfection might even be able to cancel some backs here, but King is ripping through turrets right now with the Trinity Force and Last Whisper. Christmas Tree is going to come in to run defense, but Sudden Fear are going to lose their top in here.
Yeah, it's just excellent decision from Direwolves to push with the minions, recognizing where the minion line was from Sudden Fear. Nobody's even going to die on the exit, but there's the ultimate used.
Chopper tries to flame back, but that doesn't work. Sharp in trouble as Enfamoon dives in around the side and gets a good flank there. Big Bomi in there as well. Perfection's been polymorph there, but he's in the front line trying to do damage. Brawler actually going to move in a good kick there. Perfection just takes out the support and dials. Still running in now. King getting low, but doesn't go down. Enfamoon actually gets a trade kill, but should go down. He's still alive there after the heal. Yo-Yo trying to get in, but Lucian's still not dead. Life stealing so much there, kiting back and forth. Double kill there. As Chopper tries to get the hook land in a path now. Gonna move in. Perfection wants it so bad. Lands a massive E there for some damage, but throws out the Q. Christmas Trees comes in, and now Pap's gonna dive in on top. Does get the kill, but goes down to Chopper. Chopper though will get the hook there. Can he get Enfamoon? Right in there, but the ace completed by Lucian.
MVP is Enfamoon. How did he stay alive for so long? Always found a way to open up distance. The relentless pursuit coming up at just the right time. Again, the short range mage Perfection just couldn't close the distance. And unbelievably, Sudden Fear win that fight.
I mean, looking at Baron now, can't really push, unfortunately, but who's going to be a pretty comical two-man Baron. But Enfamoon is doing so much damage.
I mean, Enfamoon does damage for two or three members, but will it be enough to DPS it down fast enough? Just looking to see if there's any blue wards. There isn't. So this is actually unpredictable coming through from Sudden Fear. Direwolves don't seem like they anticipate it or feel like they can't react. It will be Baron for Sudden Fear.
Yeah, Pink Bomi managed to run his way through there as well. So every member of Sudden Fear will get the Baron buff here. And Sudden Fear now again, another lead. It's a very slim gold lead here, and Yo-Yo is actually going to take away the dragon with the help of King. Pinkwood there is going to get cleared out. Sharps here as well, so that should be the second dragon. Sudden Fear will be denied their fourth, but Baron buff up now. Falls in their court.
I mean, second dragon for Baron is perhaps the saddest you can be for a dragon versus Baron trade. Not a lot of relevant stats coming through for the Direwolves. Sudden Fear, they already have the three. Of course, they'd love to work towards the five, but have the third dragon, have the movement speed, their rotations, and then just the rotational advantage of the 5% move speed has amplified their excellent mid-game play. And in that previous fight, the key factor, Enfamoon grouped with Christmas Trees. Christmas Trees, okay. Sion, after using his ultimate, doesn't have the most build, but he had enough to keep Enfamoon alive for the whole fight.
Yeah, and all it took was just a little bit more from the Bloodthirster. That shield being very useful. And Enfamoon has so many more items now. Finished the Last Whisper already after that fight, and even has a Spectre Scale.
But it's opted into the Spectre Scale over the Quicksilver Sash. Quicksilver Sash is actually cheaper than the Spectre Scale and has so many defensive flexible options against what Perfection's providing with the Frozen Tomb, and I think you have to respect that cooldown, because again, if the flank comes through and Enfamoon dies instantly, he's most of his team's gold, certainly most of his team's damage, and he can't afford to die. So I think you have to go for the QSS in this situation, even though you do like the health and slightly higher magic resist coming through from the Spectre's Cow.
We'll have to see how it works out for Lucian here, as Christmas Trees is using some of the brand up minions to clear out super minions here, actually. Brand minions pretty strong, actually slightly stronger than the super, so it'll take Sion a while, but he will clean it out.
He has teleports, of course, can react to any cross-map rotations that come through. Rotations being said a lot today, Pastry Time, but that's been the flavor of the game. That's the exciting thing to see. It's been a top-level game from Direwolves and Sudden Fear in the OPL, and we still have no real idea of who's going to win this one out.
No, it's a very close match here. Less than 2,000 gold between the two teams. Direwolves, with all of their wave clear, really stopping any push attempts from Sudden Fear, but don't feel comfortable doing any sort of 1-3-1 split push. So Sudden Fear going to be troublesome, actually, for them to try and break the base here, but they keep up the strong rotations, they should be able to do it.
You have to wonder, where will it be that Direwolves choose to fight? The fifth dragon, if we ever get to it, is still a long way away. They still have the Baron buff, but as you mentioned, breaking the base, that's the current win condition for Sudden Fear. It's getting some pressure on to the base, but that's probably going to be the toughest thing to do with instant wave clear from two members of Direwolves.
Yeah, King even helping out with a bit of poke, actually gets a Banshee's Veil there of Christmas trees as the wave clear still coming in. The Baron up minions are pretty strong here, but perhaps going to lean in. King takes a big chunk of damage there by LB.
And I want to see Christmas trees just go with him with Reckless Abandon. We already know that King's chunked out. You can tank this turret for days, Christmas trees. If you tell your team is on point, they've already shown that they're wonderful divers of a turret. Maybe it's time to begin.
Double Baron minions helping out there as well, but look at that wave clear.
Yeah, the wave clear coming through. Maybe the Banner of Command needed to stop this long-range magic damage wave clear. They have so little long-range physical damage that making those minions immune to magic damage, maybe that's one of the few ways they can break the base.
I mean, it sounds a little gimmicky, but would actually work perfectly fine in this situation. Blue buff, though, going to get stolen away instead, and Sudden Fear just not committing here in this late-game situation.
I mean, it's just so much more risky to dive a turret 5v5 than it was in the outnumbered situations in the bottom lane. You need that confidence. You need that clear call in your All your team needs to be on the same point. We only can speculate to how the communications are in Sudden Fear. They were definitely on point in the early game, but they need to go for that big risk, because otherwise, how are they ever going to find a fight? Because Direwolves, they can kite back very well. We already saw that in their first team fight win around Dragon, and there's not really anything to contest on the map.
No, and the Direwolves, at least in the AD carry front, are settling in for a longer game here. Infinity Edge is actually going to be the fourth item pickup here for King, a very expensive build for Corki, but lots of upfront single target damage.
And Direwolves, they're very, very smart. See, the Gank Brush comes out from Sudden Fear. They just have no reason to walk in this area. There's nothing to contest, not a fifth dragon, not even a fourth dragon to pick up, so why walk into areas that might be five man strong?
Yeah, King gonna clean out a couple creeps here, but Chopper ready with a lantern to get him out. King does find a lot of CS actually behind Lucian by quite a lot. We've had lots of farming here in this particular game. Sharp pretty far ahead of APAP, so he's been doing a lot of roaming and team fighting here on this LeBlanc. And Sudden Fear again, the lead's very slim. It's only about 1,000 gold up for them. And Dragon up in a minute 50, they'll at least have to get that.
And we should focus on that statistic, as you were mentioning, the CS between the AD carries. Of course, we trumpeted the fact that I believe at the time King averaged plus 60 CS on his opposition. We all remember the 100-plus game that he had his first time out in the OPL. It's significant. The Enfamoon coming back into this lineup is doing excellent jobs, and Christmas Tree's tanking up the turret. They're trying to out-rotate Direwolves, and they might be doing it.
Perhaps diving in for King, though, almost gets the kill. Yo-Yo gonna come in perfection. We'll move in until Enfamoon gets out immediately and pops the culling his move. But perfection gets kicked back in a sharp there. Christmas Tree's taking up a lot of damage. The Wildgrowth will find him, though, as the hook lands in there as well. The gravity field on top of it, but Sion is so tanky. And now Pap gonna dive in. Enfamoon just gets out from under perfection, but the carries are very low. Christmas Tree's actually dead here, beating on the inhibitor turret.
Yeah, beating on the inhibitor turret. That time they managed to get the Frozen 2 combination down onto Enfamoon. Even through the Banshee Veil, he doesn't die, but the QSS, of course, would have let him live that much longer to do damage in the front line. He was stopped from doing damage for a good 3-4 seconds. The lifesteal, he just needs to trade upon that and keep auto-attacking. It's why we always say cleanse on these high-damage mid laners makes so much sense, because you're about consistent damage in a fight. And for Moon, if he's ever Frozen Tombed, it's the damage lost, not necessarily the fact that he lives, that's significant.
Yes, King here. Going to clean out the mid wave here. Actually done with his Infinity Edge, so very strong on the Corki at this particular point. Lucian with the Banshee's Veil maxed out pretty much on items, even has the boots enchanted up already. Perhaps moving in for a Zonias might help with some of the offensive capabilities that Sudden Fear seem to be struggling with a little bit here in this stage of the game, but Dragon up in 15, we have our next fight point.
And it really does feel like he's item capped to some degree here, Pastry Time. You might say, but Phantom Dancer will do more single target damage. Given his team's low wave clear and the fact there's not that much armor built up upon the Direwolves, not really that significant to necessarily go for that change. So I mean, look, of course he could sell the boots at some point. That's a consideration. But with the flat movement speed, he probably needs that to stay away from the melee assassination potential of Perfection. So Enfamoon is not going to be getting any stronger, and we want to see some of the other members start to pick up CS. As Direwolves, they want their third dragon.
Yeah, and just kind of strong-arming Sudden Fury out of it. Christmas Tree is actually porting in. They're going to try and go for it. The Q will land, but the gravity field locks him up. Dragon already dead here, but Christmas Tree is looking for the fight. Enfamoon going to throw the culling in here, but Direwolves, they got what they wanted.
Culling does a lot of damage. Direwolves are very aggressively positioned. We might see the fight.
Abs gets hooked there as well, but instantly gets Wild Grip Perfection. Ults himself in the middle in a great spot there to zone out the carries. Christmas Trees trying to peel him off. There's the zone is there for Perfection as he takes out Christmas Trees. He's still alive, I think, as well. No, did actually go down, but Christmas Trees will die eventually when the passive wears off. Enfamoon now chasing in aggressively. Paps looking over the side of the wall there as well. Dives in there with one Mimic. Just Storts in as well, but Sharp zones him out with a death ray. Enfamoon going to get Chaos on there. It's chasing him, doing so much damage there as King gets out Brawl there with the Corki, and only one for one there as the front line
does.
They
just couldn't find any more picks. Lee Sin couldn't get into the middle of the fight and apply any slows. Their follow-up CC after Sion dies is quite minimal. They kind of need Sion, but we can see a one for one.
Enfamoon though does get shot down by King. Little overextended, and King happily takes him off the rift.
And King, you give him a chance for aggression, he'll take it, picks up the exit kill. 60 seconds with no Lucian is a lot of time for Direwolves to potentially pick up the Baron. And you have to think they're going to start working towards at least warding it, as there's a massive minion wave in the top that Sudden Fear needs to react to.
Yeah, Dials have done a good job protecting that part of the map here and pushing in the inhibitor already. It's respawned, of course, but they've got a lot of room here as Baron is actually back up here with the wave in the top side. You have to think that the Dials are going to get the Baron, but Sudden Fear are looking to contest for it.
They at least have wards, and Bomi, maybe he can pull off an MVP play. He's one level behind the Jarvan, but has so much execute damage. Looking for a miracle, no, backing away, respecting the gravity field. It's going to be the Direwolves Baron.
Yeah, Sharp pretty much poked him off it with Death Ray there as well, so Direwolves will collect the Baron. Sharp even using the Lantern for a bit of vision just in case the seal is forthcoming. But again, the game's been so topsy-turvy, and the Direwolves equalizing gold, but now have the Baron.
And the viewers might wonder, why didn't Lee Sin go for it? Of course, Lee Sin can often pick up these Baron steals. We all remember, we see the clips at the top of Reddit, but with no flash available, his chances of escaping if he missed out on the attempt were minimal. And having someone dead for 65 seconds this late in the game, at some points, it might be more impactful than necessarily having a Baron buff. Five members with so much gold on them is so important in the late game that in a 5v4 situation, even if the four has Baron, you often lose those team fights.
Yeah, and Sudden Fury is cleaning vision out of the jungle, taking away whatever gold they can find here. Zonya is done for Apaps, and Lucian did swap out for the Phantom Dance, so a bit more single target damage, but Lucian well and truly item capped now.
And if you're team fighting, absolutely the Phantom Dancer will do more damage. So again, he's looking to do damage to champions, not necessarily looking for wave clear, just have to rely on his team to put that up. It's an aggressive decision. I think it's probably the right one. And yeah, the only option he has is the ultimate luxury, it's to pick up the Zephyr for boots.
And you know what? That might just be not enough mobility given how many threats are on the Wolf side that can dive in. We've seen Perfection to play so beautifully on the front line with this mage here, and even Lissandra at this point's kind of maxed out on items. This has been one of the longer OPL games that we've ever had, and the Dials now on the front foot with their Baron buff.
Now the rotation and top lane for Dials, they're pushing very aggressively. Of course, there's an open inhibitor, and they have to react to this Sudden Fear. So Perfection, he can push in the melee, doesn't have teleport available, so they're not going to contest too hard in terms of pushing for this top inhibitor turret. But with no turret being available, and not that much wave clear for Sudden Fear, it's just a bit of a standstill around the map. Ooh,
King has to be very careful, gets spotted out there by Enfamoon's Ardent Blaze, but Dials instead going to take the last tier 2 turret that they have available to them here in the midsection of the map. Perfection, Elixir's ticking away as well. I mean, everyone at this point, 6 Slotted with Elixir's ticking. There's so much damage on both sides.
There's minions around the map to react to. We can see Christmas Trees on the mini-map reacting to a massive push in bottom. He doesn't have teleport available either. Even though he's very mobile with his ultimate, it will take time, and Dials might try to rush down this inhibitor.
Oh, Chuffer finds Papsir out of the Mimic, I believe. There gets played back as well, and the damage coming in for Victor is just disgusting. Paps will go down there as Sharp gets the kill. Christmas Trees trying to fight here as another hook lands onto Brawler this time. He's played back and destroyed as well, and that's 2 clean kills for the Wolves.
Yeah, will they be able to hold the base?
And
there's the Frozen 2.
Ulti there as well. King going in there, gets the double. Once more, the Christmas Trees might make it a triple here, and the Dials, they've done it.
Direwolves have done it. They've come back. These experienced teams find ways to win, but Sudden Fear were oh so impressive for at least 30 minutes of this game. Direwolves bring it out, and that's the win.
Very strong stuff there. The experience really paying off, and a slim lead there at the end. Only 5,500 gold between those two teams, and given how well they both played, the game ending at a very late spot there. a formidable fight put up by Sudden Fear.
And Pastry Time, Sudden Fear were actually ahead in kills as the game ended. Not quite gold. Of course, a lot of gold when those structures come down. But just like LeBlanc in the previous game, this was actually a team-wide excellent performance from Sudden Fear, but no points to show for their excellent efforts.
Yeah, couldn't quite close it out, but we do have a replay there from that game as well. So let's check out one of the late-game team fights.
Absolutely, and it's in fact the last team fight, Pastry Time, as we roll the clip onto the inhibitor. It's the picks that come through from Chuffer, making up for a lax early game. They get the pick onto Paps. He doesn't die. He's actually managed to Zonya's, but will eventually be picked out. But watch the second death sentence as well. This is the one that sealed the game. We might have actually seen the game be extended, but Brawler dies as well. 5v3 with Baron minions, just nothing Sudden Fear could do. And Enfermoon, 500 range, that's the danger in the late game. You get exploded by perfection. So excellent play from Sudden Fear, but Direwolves, they find a way to win. 7-2 now for the OPL. And they look to just trying to extend that lead in second place.
Yeah, and a tough loss there for Sudden Fear. They'll have to shake it off. They've got another game coming up right after this. After a quick break, we'll pop back and 4-0.